Hello dear students, this is another session on histological staining techniques. In previous sessions, we discussed about fixation, then about embedding, the objectives of embedding, about embedding media, then the different types of molds used for embedding, then about the wax which is used for embedding. Also, we discussed about devices used for embedding. There is tissue embedding machine, such things we discussed. Then the method of embedding also we discussed. This section is on sectioning. So after embedding, during embedding, we are embedding the tissue or the specimen inside wax or another embedding media like epoxy resin. Epoxy resin we use in case we are using electron microscope. For the other cases, other microscopes we use paraffin wax as embedding medium. There are also several other embedding media. After embedding this in an embedding media, it is made into a block. We embed the tissue inside embedding media in such a way that we make a block, and this is now sectioned. After embedding, this embedded block is sectioned to make serial sections of the tissue. So sectioning is the next stage in the staining procedure, histological staining procedure. So very thin sections of the embedded material are required to make permanent or temporary slides to enable viewing through the microscope. So when we are making this permanent or temporary slides of certain tissues, mainly tissues or some other parts of an organism or a cell, when we make this permanent or temporary slides, we require thin sections, mainly in the case of tissues. Or when we are studying the whole organism, small organisms, when we want to study the tissues or different organs, we need thin sections. And these thin sections are made into permanent or temporary slides. And this is very important while viewing through the microscope. The thickness of the section, it is very important while viewing the specimen through the microscope. The thinner the section, the greater the clarity, and we will be able to see the details of the tissues, details of the cells in the tissues. So the block made of embedding material, paraffin wax, epoxy resin, etc., are used as embedding material. So the block made of this embedding material, which contains a specimen or the tissue, is cut into specific thickness using instruments called microtomes. We can adjust the thickness. We can specify the thickness in microtomes. There are several microtomes like rotary microtome, sludge microtome, ultra microtome, cryo microtome, rocking microtome, laser microtome. There are several microtomes to produce serial sections. And the thickness of this section can be predetermined. We can set the thickness of the section in these microtomes according to the purpose. So each microtome is having its specific applications. Ultra microtome is used to produce extremely thin sections for electron microscopy. And freezing microtome or cryo microtome, that is used for soft tissues as well as for other tissues it is used, but specifically for soft tissues, freezing microtome. Here the tissues are rapidly frozen and sectioned directly without fixing and embedding. So since this fixing and embedding steps are not there, The chemical damage to the tissue is reduced here. And about more details of microderm, you can view the YouTube video on microderm already posted. So next is about staining. So while sectioning in the microderm, we get serial sections of a tissue or a specimen. We obtain the serial sections of the specimen or the tissue that we have embedded in the embedding material. And along with this tissue, there will be the embedding material also. So if we have embedded in paraffin wax, when we take the serial sections, in that sections, there will be this wax surrounding the section. Also, this section is infiltrated with the embedding media before it is embedded. Okay, that step is known as infiltration. So there is a presence of this wax in the section, in the tissue section as well as around the section. So that should be kept in mind. So that wax we need to remove. There are various ways to remove the wax from the section. So first about the staining, the purpose of staining. So the first purpose is to enhance contrast at microscopic level between cells and surrounding medium, as well as between structures within the cell. Then the second purpose, to visualize cells better. Third one, to highlight metabolic processes in the cell. Fourth one, to define biological tissues, for example, muscle fibers, connective tissue, etc. Next, it is used to identify different cell populations. Example, different types of blood cells can be identified by staining. Then it is used to define organelles within individual cells. We can differentiate organelles inside the cell, and we can view each different organelles inside the individual cells. Then it is used to mark cells in flow cytometry. Flow cytometry is a technique. In this technique, staining is used to mark cells. Then also it is used to flag proteins or nucleic acids in gel electrophoresis. And this staining, it is not limited to biological materials. It can also be used to study other materials such as lamellar structures of semi-crystalline polymers, etc. So these are the various purposes of staining. Many are there. Many more are there. These are some of the purposes of staining. Then about the stain. Stain is also known as dye. So this each stain, it is having a chromophoric part and a oxochromic part. Chromophore. It is responsible for staining. Chromophore is responsible for staining. Then oxochrome, that is the next part. It assists in staining, and they are salt forming radicals. So these are the two components of a stain, chromophore and oxochrome. For example, basic fission, that is a stain. It is p-rosanilin chloride, basic fission. Here, aniline is the chromophore and p-toluidin is the oxochrome. Then about acidic stains and basic stains. Or we can also say acidic dyes and basic dyes. So in acidic dyes, they possess radicals that yield hydroxyl ions. And your chromophoric group is an anion. And they have strong affinity for cytoplasmic constituents of the tissues. And they form salts with alkalis. Example, acid fission, methyl blue, eosin, orangey, concoret, bismarck, brown, aniline blue. About basic dyes, they possess amino radicals that yield hydroxyl ions. Also, the chromophoric group is a cation here, and they preferentially stain cell nucleus and they form salts with acids. Example, basic fission, methyl green, crystal violet, hematoxylin, safranin. Next, about mordants. Mordants are used along with dyes. These are substances used to increase affinity of the tissues for a stain or a dye. Okay, these mordants are substances used to increase affinity of the tissues to a dye. And in the presence of mordants, the staining property of the dye increases. And it is used in different ways. Some used before fixing the tissue. Some used along with the stains. And the commonly used mordants are chromium trioxide, iron alum, ammonium molybdate, picric acid. Then there is a term known as lake, associated with mordants. Lake. This is the insoluble colored precipitate formed by the reaction between mordant and dye. Okay, lake is the insoluble colored precipitate formed by the reaction between mordant and dye. This is formed whenever we use a mordant along with a dye or a stain. The next is a term known as metachromasia. This is some stains, mainly basic stains or basic dyes. They stain various components of the cell totally different from the color of the dye. They stain the different components inside the cell different from the color of the dye. That property is known as metachromasia. For example, toluidine blue. Toluidine blue is a stain. This toluidine blue stains nuclei blue in color, cytoplasmic RNA pink in color, and glycoproteins red in color. Okay, and this dye as itself, it is blue in color. But it stains nuclei blue in color, cytoplasmic RNA pink in color, and glycoproteins red in color. This property is known as metachromasia. Next, about staining of hormones. The practice of placing entire organism on slide for microscopic examination is known as hormones. And this can be done only with very small organisms. Very, very small organisms. We place the entire organism on this slide and stain it. We make a hole mound of it. We make a permanent slide out of it. That is mainly known as hole mounds. And this hole mounds is also referred to staining pieces of tissues without sectioning. Usually embryos are stained like that. The complete embryos are stained without sectioning. That complete full embryo is stained without sectioning. That is also referred to as hole mounds. So the organisms or parts of the organisms used for hole mounds should be thin enough to be studied by the transmitted light. Otherwise, it is of no use. That hole mound is of no use. So it should be thin enough to be studied under the microscope. Only such parts can be used for hole mounds, or such tissues, such organisms can be used as hole mounds, or such pieces of tissues can be used as hole mounds. When it is very thin, that we can study it under the microscope. And stains commonly used for hole mounds are borax carmin, alum carmin, acetocarmin. Next is staining of serial sections. Serial sections, we already told what are these serial sections. When we take sections using a microtome, we obtain serial sections. The section will be coming one after the another as a ribbon. And this is known as serial sections. And there is a presence of paraffin inside the tissue as well as around the tissue in the serial sections. So during the staining procedure, from the start we can say, first was the fixation. Then the next step is dehydration. Then the next step is clearing. Then there is infiltration with the embedding media. Then the embedding itself is there. that is we are embedding the tissue inside a embedding media like paraffin wax, and a block is obtained, and this block is sectioned using a microtome, and we obtain serial sections which are extremely thin, and this can be stained now. But before staining, there is another step. These thin serial sections are paraffin embedded, isn't it? Because there are two steps in which we are using this embedding media, that is in infiltration as well as in embedding. So these wax should be removed from the sections, from the serial sections. So that is known as deparaffinization. So after deparaffinization, the sections are stained using suitable dyes or stains. Okay, so there is this deparaffinization. This is because these thin serial sections which are obtained after sectioning using a microtome, it contains the embedding media. That should be, mostly it will be paraffin wax, and that's why we are calling this step deparaffinization. That wax should be removed, and that step is known as deparaffinization. So after deparaffinization, these sections are stained using suitable dyes, and permanent stained preparation is done. Permanent slides are prepared. So the most to make this permanent slides, we need to stain the sections using suitable dyes. And most widely used method for serial sections of tissues obtained using a microtome is double staining. For serial sections, we usually use double staining. The staining method is double staining. So what is double staining? It involves using a primary stain and a counter stain. So double staining, it involves a nuclear stain which is known as the primary stain, and a cytoplasmic stain which is known as the counter stain. So the tissue is first stained with a nuclear stain, and then it is counter stained with a cytoplasmic stain. And now the nuclear will appear blue and cytoplasm will appear pinkish red in color. So we can differentiate the nucleus and the cytoplasm. This is the use of double staining to differentiate different parts of the cell. So here a nuclear stain is used which is acting as the primary stain, and a cytoplasmic stain is used which is acting as a counter stain. Then multiple staining. There is another staining procedure known as multiple staining. In certain cases, instead of double staining, multiple staining is carried out. Here one primary stain is used and two or more counter stains are used here. For example, Mallory's triple stain. This produces best results with most tissues, the serial sections of most tissues. Here the primary stain is an acid fission and counter stain is aniline blue and orangey. Okay, primary stain is acid fission and counter stains are aniline blue and orangey. And after the staining, after staining with Mallory's triple stain, we can see chromatin, deep pink or red in color, cytoplasm in varying shades of pink, connective tissue in blue color, and blood cells in orange color. Okay, that this is known as multiple staining. So, I'm closing for this time being. Thank you for your patient listening.